In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My Lord and my God, I firmly believe that you are here, that you see me, that you hear me. I adore you with profound reverence. I ask you pardon for my sins, and the grace to spend this time of prayer fruitfully. My Immaculate Mother, Saint Joseph, my Father and Lord, my guardian angel, intercede for me. The octave of Christian unity concludes today with the commemoration of the conversion of Saint Paul. Saul, we read in the first reading, taken from the Acts of the Apostles, still breathing murderous threats against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues in Damascus, that if he should find men, any men or women who belong to the way, at that time, Christianity was not called that, nor were the first Christians called Christians. It was just the way. He might bring them back to Jerusalem in chains. On his journey, as he was nearing Damascus, a light from the sky suddenly flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" And he said, "Who are you, Lord?" And the reply came, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. Now get up and go into the city, for you will be told what you must do." Now the men who were traveling with him stood speechless, for they heard the voice, but could not see anyone. So Saul got up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he could see nothing. So they led him up, they led him rather by the hand, and brought him to Damascus. And for 3 days he was unable to see, and he neither ate nor drank. First of all, let's get into the literal sense of the passage. It's pretty straightforward. Saul, who at that time was a young man, relatively young, was a Pharisee, belonging to the most, shall we say, faithful line of Judaism. He had been a student of the great teacher, Gamaliel. So he was schooled in the faith, schooled in sacred scripture. And that's the reason why he recognized immediately that the way, what was being preached by Jesus Christ, by that man who had just been, shall we say, condemned to death by, first of all, by the Sanhedrin, and also, shall we say, approved of by the Roman governor, and they had executed him through the most, shall we say, ignominious way of crucifixion and Calvary. And when the prophet Stephen had been martyred, stoned to death, you will recall that in the account of the Acts of the Apostles, the men who cast stones at him, who stoned him, laid aside their garments and put them at the foot of a young man named Saul. He was this Saul. And years later, a few years later, not content with persecuting the Jews in Jerusalem, rather the Christians, the followers of Christ in Jerusalem, he had gotten papers authorizing him to ferret out the followers of the way who had fled to Damascus and to bring them back in chains to Jerusalem, there to be judged by the Sanhedrin. Damascus is about 40 kilometers north of Jerusalem. It's Syria. It's in Syria, rather. And that would have entailed a good day's travel by horse. It wasn't very far. in Rome, in Piazza del Popolo. It's a piazza there with twin churches. One of the twin churches precisely has a big painting facing the altar to the left by the famous Italian painter Caravaggio, whose style, as you know very well, is the chiaroscuro, very dark paintings, shadows and darkness of this particular scene of Saint Paul falling down his horse at the gates of Damascus. It's a very striking painting. In any case, so that was the scenario. And as he approached Damascus, precisely at the city gates, this a light shone. And then there was something like thunder that must have scared his horse, and it must have reared on his hinds, and so he fell to the ground. And that voice was heard, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" Which was heard by the other people accompanying him, although they could not see anything, neither could he. It was just a voice. And so he replied, "Who are you, Lord?" And that voice, "I am Jesus whom you are persecuting." And he was stopped at the literal sense and segue to the spiritual sense. You see how our Lord identifies his followers with him as early as that. In other words, if Saul was persecuting his followers, then in effect he was persecuting him. Christ and the church are one. The mystical body, the church is the mystical body of Christ. No one can attack the church and say that he's not attacking Christ. And there's a reason why all these other denominations that attack the church, purporting to do so as an act of fidelity to Christ, to the gospel. Remember that that's the, first of all, the one who first had that idea was actually Muhammad. That's the reason why he founded Islam, because he said that the Jews had not been faithful to the Old Testament, the Christians neither had been faithful to the teachings of Jesus Christ, the great prophet. So now, as the last of the lines of the prophets, he was establishing a new religion. And later on, all kinds of heresies would arise in the church, including the Protestant heresy, purporting always with good intention, to be faithful to the teaching of Christ, to the faithful to sacred scripture, but in the process, putting aside the church that Jesus Christ had established. Well, that's just not possible. Because our Lord himself, remember, told the apostles, who gathers with you, who is with you, is with me. Who does not work with you, scatters. Whoever listens to you, listens to me. And whoever doesn't listen to you, doesn't listen to me. And the words that I have spoken are not mine, but from the Father. You see the line of revelation. God is God. But he reveals himself to us first through the prophets in a veiled way, but in the fullness of time through Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who was made man to teach and to bring to fulfillment the task of revelation, of God revealing himself to man. And that Jesus Christ established the church in the scene that we're contemplating very much in its inception, but already identifying the church with him. That the church is Christ's presence in history. The logic is very simple. Jesus Christ is the fullness of revelation. He's the one who died on the cross in order to redeem us. First, he did good. He did, I mean, to say he performed good works, chepit facere et docere, and then he taught. But Jesus Christ had to die on the cross. That was a deal. And had to resurrect and to ascend in order to occupy his place at the right of the Father. And so what about humanity? After that euphoria of the resurrection and the ascension, what happens next? We, with our materialism, meaning to say we're steeped in matter, we, with our sensibilities, we're so dependent on our external senses. What then? So the same logic that made Jesus Christ establish the sacraments, visible sign for him to bestow grace, visible signs that carry out what they signify, those are the sacraments, starting from baptism to confirmation, passing through communion and penance, and all the way to the grave with the anointing of the sick. He also established the great commandment, the great sacrament, rather, which is the church. His visible presence in history, because the church is the mystical body of Christ. And that's the first lesson of this reading of what we're commemorating today. That we cannot separate the church from Jesus Christ. And neither can we separate, therefore, the lawful authority of the church, meaning to say the hierarchy, Peter and the apostles united around him, the Pope and the bishops united around him to form the college. We cannot separate that from fidelity to Jesus Christ and therefore fidelity to God. Ubi Petrus, ibi Ecclesia, ibi Deus. Where Peter is, there is the church, and where the church is, there is God, there is Jesus Christ. That's the first lesson. But then we continue our reading. That Saul spent the next 3 days blinded in prayer and fasting. This is a common thing that happens in sacred scripture. It happened with the prophets, it happened with St. John the Baptist, who spent years in the desert, purifying himself in a very ascetic existence, dressed in camel's hair, camel's skin. You can imagine how tough a hide that is, and subsisting on a diet on locusts and wild honey. Locusts for protein and wild honey for carbs. Why a diet like that? Because that's the only thing you can find in the Judean wilderness. It's desert. Very little vegetation there. And yet he was there. What for? The same reason why Saul was for 3 days not eating. Because what gets in the way of God's revelation, what gets in the way of, shall we say, prayer, which is conversation with God, in order to receive not only the good news, but everything, all the revelation. What gets in the way of that is our, shall we say, disordered passions, our worldliness, our, shall we say, tendency to pleasure and materialism. That's what gets in the way. And there's a reason why penance, contrition, has always been linked with ascetical practice, a spirit of mortification. It's not as if God enjoys seeing us suffer. He's not a sadist. He's a good father. But the reality is that we, because of original sin, because of the scars left behind by sin, have a way of getting lost with matter. Our tendency to pleasure, our, shall we say, aversion to any sacrifice, to any effort, our tendency to material things, and our kind of, if not exactly aversion, but lack of appetite for elevated, sublime spiritual realities. No, I mean, a very good test of this. During the height of the pandemic, when, you know, people had the option, the only option, of going to Mass through the television, Haven't you ever experienced a kind of a tug of war between having to attend mass on television and going to Netflix or HBO or whatever other program you might have there? Perhaps it was even just a sports channel. That's the thing. Rather than go to that sublime reality, which is the Holy Mass, the sacrifice of Calvary, the reason for our redemption. Can you imagine even having to make a second thought? Even consider the possibility of missing that in order to watch a great basketball game or football game or a film. But that happens. That just shows you the disorder in our passions. Well, this is the thing that gets in the way of prayer. So when a person really wants to pray, and in that particular moment, Saul was in a earth-shaking situation, life-changing episode. His whole life was being changed at that moment. Well, he had to pray. And he did so by purifying himself, fasting, both from food and from water. And on the third day, the next steps happen. There was a disciple in Damascus named Ananias. And the Lord said to him in a vision, "Ananias," he answered, "Here I am, Lord." And the Lord said to him, "Get up and go to the street called Straight Street, and ask at the house of Judas for a man from Tarsus named Saul. He is there praying, and in a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias come in and lay his hands on him, that he may regain his sight." In other words, the voice was telling Ananias, go there to this Saul from Tarsus, because that Saul of Tarsus has had a vision of you going to him. So in other words, you're expected. But Ananias replied, "Lord, I have heard from many sources about this man, what evil things he has done to your holy ones in Jerusalem. And here he has authority from the chief priests to imprison all who call upon your name." But the Lord said to him, "Go, for this man is a chosen instrument of mine to carry my name before the Gentiles, kings and children of Israel. And I will show him what he will have to suffer for my name." So Ananias went and entered the house, laying his hands on him. And he said, "Saul, my brother, the Lord has sent me, Jesus, who appeared to you on the way by which you came, that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." And immediately, things like scales fell from his eyes. It was just like cataracts. And he regained his sight. And he got up and was baptized, and when he had eaten, he recovered his strength. Again, it's pretty straightforward, literal sense of that. So let's jump immediately to the spiritual sense. After that moment, Saul had been doing what he thought was God's will, protect the Jewish tradition, preserve fidelity to the law and to the prophets. And so therefore persecute the followers of Jesus Christ who were following a slightly different path. Not slightly, because the Judeo-Christian tradition is continuous. In other words, Christianity came to fulfill Judaism, not break it. Our Lord himself would say that, had said that, "I have not come to abolish the law, but to fulfill it." The chosen race were chosen in order to prepare for the coming of the Messiah. And so the Messiah is not going to abrogate the terms of the old covenant, but he has to fulfill it, to perfect it. And that's what Saul had seen in his prayer those 3 days. So the coming of Ananias to Saul and the laying on of his hands was just a confirmation, a, shall we say, completion of a task that had been going on for the past 3 days, which traditionally were referred to as the conversion of Saul, of St. Paul. But if you look at it closer, you will realize that it was not really a conversion. It's not as if Saul had been going against the will of God, had been unfaithful, had been living a profligate existence up to that moment. On the contrary, if he was pursuing the followers of Christ, it was in fulfillment of what he thought was the will of God, fidelity to the covenant. In much the same way that when our Blessed Mother received the Annunciation that she was going to be the mother of the Redeemer, and the clarification of how that was going to be, there was no if and but. There was no, shall we say, negotiation. There was no bargaining. The immediate response was, "Behold the handmaid of the Lord, let it be done unto me according to thy word." And you can be sure that that reply, that, shall we say, decision at that moment, was not the decision of a moment. It was the attitude of a lifetime. The same thing happened with Saul. The so-called conversion of Saul was not the conversion from away from God and in order to go back to God. It was not an aversio a creaturas and a conversione a Deus or a Deum, but rather it was a refinement, a fine-tuning of the attitude of a lifetime. This has to be our conversions too. After the initial conversion from our sinful ways to the following of Christ, what will follow is a lifetime of struggling, of refinement. Oh my Lord, how patient you are with us. How loving you are with us. We want to love you too. But we go astray at times. We get distracted at times. Well, may we learn from the example of Saul, of St. Paul, the remedy to those distractions, the way to make those refinements, to those, well, okay, call it that, conversions from distractions in order to get back on track or to fine-tune so that we are even more in the groove, more on point, is prayer and penance. Penance in order to detach ourselves from all those attachments. Penance in order to break the shackles that are keeping us from freely flying to the heights of dialogue with God and following His way. That's penance and prayer, that dialogue. We have to end. Today is a great day in order to celebrate this reality of our conversion too. And like Saul, perhaps we at times really need a real conversion in the sense that we turn our back on you, my Lord. We turn our back on you in order to pleasure ourselves by turning into creatures, turning to creatures rather, to please us. Well, give us the grace. If necessary, knock us off our high horse. But don't allow us to be blinded for too long. Blinded by our own miseries, blinded by our own attachments, blinded perhaps even by our own failures. You know, failures of a way of blinding us and making us forget what we really are for and give up the project. What's the use? We sometimes say, well, when those moments come, when those times come, may we too find our Ananias in the person of that priest to whom we will go to confession, or that person with whom we open up in spiritual direction. Our Ananias, who could be our own parents, our own siblings, our friends, could open up new horizons of greater fidelity for us, inviting us to make a recollection or to attend a close retreat, inviting us to go to confession. Well, let's not be aloof from these things. Let's not say, I already know it. I know myself better. Who can possibly tell me better what I need? Well, all of us, we need an Ananias. Saul was a great figure. Erudite, a faithful Jew. But at a given moment, he needed his Ananias. And we too will need ours if we're going to find our own Damascus. And all of us will have our Damascus. Time of conversion, time of renewal, time of fine-tuning. And that way, like Saul also, who became the apostle to the Gentiles, the great Paul, who knows what great things are in store for us. Many great things depend on forgetting, on whether you and I live our lives as God wants. And where that begins, where that conversion begins, is that encounter, our Damascus, with grace, with the light of grace, that we have to correspond to with penance. Here I am, Lord, because you have called me. Spend a few moments or minutes concretizing your resolution before ending this prayer.